Welcome back to News Talk here on News Channel 8. I'm Bruce DePoy, joined at the table today by former Prince George's prosecutor Glenn Ivey, Maryland State Delegate Jocelyn Pena-Melnick, former Maryland Lieutenant Governor Anthony Brown. They are widely perceived to be the top candidates in the upcoming Democratic primary in the 4th Congressional District in Maryland. Open voting underway now, so no excuse if you want to vote before primary day. Have at it. Polling locations are open. The primary, of course, is April 26th. We're talking with the candidates widely perceived to be the front runners in the race to succeed Donna Edwards in the U.S. House of Representatives in the 4th Congressional District. I want to ask you all about entitlements. The ratio of active workers, people who are in the workforce drawing a paycheck and paying into the federal treasury now, relative to retirees, has been shifting, and there's every likelihood it will continue to shift for a very long time. This is going to put a squeeze on programs that sometimes we call entitlements. Social Security really isn't an entitlement, but these are important safety net programs. When you think about the numbers, and we can stipulate and not waste time talking too much about how important these programs are, the folks listening to us today get it. How do we deal with the challenge the numbers represent, Lieutenant Governor Brown?
Well, sir, I've said consistently that, you know, the wealthiest Americans have to pay their fair share to fund many important programs, and one of them is how do we take care of our seniors, our Americans in retirement. Some may have a 401k or a private pension. A lot will rely on Social Security. That's why supporting increasing the cap on the payroll for the payroll tax purposes up to $250,000 and above. And we need to look to strengthen Social Security. I've advocated for changing the cost of living to the Consumer Price Index. It more closely reflects what seniors are paying every day and not what urban workers are paying.
Should someone who's in their 30s now expect to have a trigger that's north of, given life expectancy, health improvements, and a desire to see the system be solvent, should people who are in their 30s today who have a long sort of lead time to absorb any change that we might enact, should that be part of the equation too?
Well, I'll give you an example to answer your question. I don't support raising the retirement age for Social Security.
Even 30 years out for people
look,
who are young?
For some people, I'm not on a jackhammer every day, but I can tell you right now, you tell a worker who is looking to retire in their early 60s, who's on a jackhammer every day of their life, that you're going to have to work until 70 as your minimum retirement age, mm-hmm. That's a tough 10 years. So I don't support that.
Jocelyn Pena-Melnick?
You know, I agree with everything Anthony said, but in addition to that, you know, Bruce, we're lucky. Some of us have a pension. We're not just relying on Social Security, but they're the seniors and the people that are disabled. That's all they have. That's all they're counting on, and we need to make sure we protect it. However, we need to make sure we close the corporate loopholes, that corporations pay their fair share, and we need to make sure that people that are high income earners pay more than the poor people and middle class people.
Glenn Ivey.
I think I agree with what Anthony said, but I just want to be clear. I would say people making above 250, you're going to have to pay more, but between 118 and 250, I wouldn't increase the FICA tax for that group. I would leave it just like it is, and I think that's still enough to keep everything solvent and going in the right direction. As far as raising the age, we're already a point where minorities, especially black males, die before they hit the age where they're old enough to collect. There's a disability payment that goes to the family, but moving the age up even further makes it even less likely that they're going to collect and reduces the number of the amount of benefits that's going to go to them.
Europe is facing the worst refugee and humanitarian crisis it has seen since World War II. Does the U.S. have a role in helping address this humanitarian disaster?
Me?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I think Syria is generating the problem. I think we're doing a lot to try and bring some sort of ceasefire to Syria, you know, with mixed results. But I don't think you're going to fix the refugee problem until the Syria crisis is addressed, because it's forcing people out of the country. So I like what John Kerry and others are doing to try and move that forward. ISIS is a big part of the challenge as well, and we can get into that later if you want. I think the taking in refugees, there was a lot of misinformation put out there by Ted Cruz and others, that, you know, these people are going to be flocking over here and they could be ISIS members. It's an 18-month vetting process before they're permitted in. So I don't think there's a risk there.
Jocelyn Pena-Melnick.
Yes, I agree. I think that, you know, this is a beautiful country. I'm an immigrant myself. I am where I am. I'm the living example of the American dream. We should take them in. The CIA, the FBI, they're doing a great, fantastic background check. we should allow them to come. This is a country that gives opportunities, and I think that what we need to do is work with our allies, make sure that we exchange information and that we work together.
Anthony Brown.
Absolutely. I mean, I don't think we disagree here at all. I think as a nation, we can accept refugees. We are a nation of immigrants. My family, my father, I'm a first-generation American. People come to this country not only to benefit from the greatness that is America, but to contribute to the greatness that is America. There's a lot of fear about bringing refugees to this country, particularly from Syria. But as Glenn mentioned, and I think, you know, Jocelyn Peña-Melnick acknowledges as well, it's an 18 to 24 month vetting period. You can get a student visa or work visa a lot easier. And when you think about 9/11 and the perpetrators there, they didn't come in on a refugee status. They came under work permit, work visas, student visas, and travel visas, where you have less of a vetting process. So we can welcome new Americans, refugees, and we need to step up our security checks on anyone who's coming to this country.
Well, I have a Wall Street question for you. I finally got around to seeing The Big Short, and it, to me, the movie delivers a real powerful message about our system at multiple levels. Anthony Brown, can you explain why no one, effectively, has been prosecuted for a series of fraudulent acts that tanked the global economy, from the people who sold financial products, instruments, what have you, that were not as advertised in terms of their quality and stability level, and the rating agencies that were complicit clearly in everything that went down, that took our economy into the sewer and the global economy with it? And yet we have a system where that happens and no one's prosecuted. You've all dealt with people from the corporate world. You all know the law. Why did this happen?
Sure. Well, first of all, it troubles me that Wall Street basically bankrupted many families, caused many families, particularly in the African American community, to lose the vast majority of their wealth, which was in home ownership. So I was very supportive of the passage of Dodd-Frank. We need to have regulators on the job and regulations to give them the opportunity to break up big banks that want to engage in risky investments. I support, for example, a speculation or risk tax. If not only big banks, but hedge funds want to invest in risky short-term transactions instead of safer, longer-term transactions, we ought to break them up.
Glenn Ivey, I can't help but be curious why no one's been prosecuted. You know the law, you know prosecution. You'll get a minute. I have to go to break at that point. Why has no one been prosecuted?
Well, I think the challenge is to make sure that you can pull these cases together in a way that you can identify individuals and prove that they were individually guilty beyond a reasonable doubt.
It's been 8 years.
It has, and I haven't tracked the cases. I know they've gotten big settlements. I think they just announced, for example, I think it was a $5 billion settlement last week against Goldman Sachs. Mm-hmm. If I recall correctly, and hopefully that money will be put back in to help people stay in their houses and to make people whole who were damaged by this.
$5 billion in a settlement, and yet no one's done anything wrong, apparently.
It's a huge challenge, and I think the key, too, is to make sure that the regulators who are dealing with this part need to step up, because they were letting loans go through that they really should have blocked and shut down.
Delegate.
You know, it's a huge challenge, it's true, but it doesn't mean that we shouldn't go after them. You know, what it shows is that justice is not blind. It's still in this country, if you have money, if you have a certain class, you can get away with things.
Too big to jail?
That's right. You and I would not get away with it, but they do. And we need to focus on that, and we need to make sure that we have the regulators in place, and we need to go after them. They need to pay.
We're at the midpoint of our conversation with our candidates here today. We'll have more straight ahead on air and, as always, online on our blog. It's news8newstalk.com. We pause here. We're back with more right here on News Talk on News Channel 8 right after this.